Today's presentation is from Gael Camden de Teyu, who is currently at Old Dominion University, one of the partner institutions at CREDSI. And this is about addressing advanced persistent threats in OT networks of utilities, and advanced persistent threat being advanced, meaning that it's not just a one-time hack they get in. Persistent meaning that they're in for a long time and they're able to move around. And I believe that Gael's work will present a defender game theoretic approach so that both power system OT can optimize its defenses against these threats. Gael earned a PhD from Télécom Paris Tech, which is in France, the top French engineering school in computer science. And after various jobs in France, he has joined the Virginia Modeling and Simulation Center at Old Dominion as a postdoctoral researcher. So Gael, it's all yours.
Hi, thank you, and hi to everybody. I hope everyone can hear me.
Yeah, we can hear you well,
Gael. Okay, nice. So my presentation of today will be about security games for cyber resilient build power system. And this is the outline. So I will first type the introduction, and then I will describe the general architecture of power grid. And then we will have some mathematical analysis on the vulnerability graph, and then on to play a zero, some Markov game, and then I will finish with simulation and conclusion. So today, the extensive use of information and communication technologies in industrial control system make them vulnerable to cyber attacks. And one particular class of cyber attack is advanced persistent threats. In this kind of attacks, the attacker can steal the credential of user and then move laterally in the network from node to node until they reach a sensitive target. So the attacker are very sophisticated. They can adapt to defenders' efforts. They can buy or develop zero-day exploits, and their persistence means that they have a specific goal, and they will continue the attack until they achieve the goal. And most of the time, there is an entity behind the attack, like a group or a government. Industrial control system manage critical infrastructure that are important for the security of a nation, and this critical infrastructure are systems like a power grid, oil and gas, water supply, information and telecommunication, transportation. And today we have more and more attacks on this critical infrastructure. One example is the attack on the Ukraine power grid in 2015. This attack was considered as the first non-successful cyber attack on the power grid, and hackers were able to compromise the corporate networks using spear phishing emails with black energy trojan. And then remotely, the attacker took control of the SCADA network, and then they switched off some power substation and disrupted electricity to the end customer. They also destroy some file on server and make some data of service attack. 1 year later, another attack occurs on the power grid in Ukraine. And the attacker used also email with infected attachment, and then they were able to steal the user credential, and then they took control of the power grid and cut circuit breaker at nearly 60 substations.
today there is a need to have resilient power grid. This means resilience can be defined as the ability to plan, the ability to absorb the attack, minimize the impact, and the ability to take recovery action to recover from the attack. And there is one framework in the literature called the AFOM framework that has four resilient metrics described as the rapidity, the resourcefulness, the robustness, and the redundancy. And here we are going to work on three metrics: rapidity, resourcefulness, and robustness. By rapidity, we mean to reduce the delay between the moment of the detection of the malware and the response action. Because once the malware has been detected in the system, appropriate and timely action should be taken quickly to prevent the malware going deeper in the system. By resourcefulness, we mean to take the appropriate action. For example, by finding the right vulnerable services to shut down. And by robustness, we mean by minimizing the impact of the attack. For example, we may redirect the malware into part of the system where critical assets cannot be reached. Now we are going to have an overview of a power grid system. So this is the recommended defense in depth architecture for industrial system. This architecture is proposed by NIST, and you can have more information about that in the NIST report. In this architecture, we have a certain number of layers. The top layer right here is the power grid that consists of substation, transformer, transmission line. We have other layers like the corporate DMZ, the corporate network, the control system DMZ, and the control system. The control system consists of equipment like application server, historian database, configuration server that control the power grid. And the corporate network consists of equipment like web application server, business workstation, and user in this layer, user in the corporate network, they don't have the skills to operate in the control system. And in addition, in the corporate network, you have internet access, you have FTP traffic, email traffic, and this traffic cannot be carried on the control system. Because if this traffic is carried on the control system, this traffic could be easily intercepted and denial of service attack could occur, and the control system could be easily compromised. So the corporate network should be isolated from the control system with a firewall and with the DMZ. In the DMZ, we put equipment of the control system that need to be reached from the corporate network in such a way that no direct communication is needed from the corporate network to the control system. So to access the control system from the corporate network, a user must first have access to the control DMZ, the control system DMZ, and then from the control system DMZ, the user will go to the control system. In the same way, there is a corporate DMZ between outside of the network and the corporate network, such that no direct communication is possible from outside to the corporate network. Now, we are going to analyze a particular example of attack. So let us say that, let us imagine, let us assume that there are some vulnerability on web server in the system. And a remote attacker can exploit this vulnerability to move laterally in the network. So for example, he will first compromise the corporate firewall, and then from the corporate firewall, he will compromise the web server in the DMZ, in the corporate DMZ, and then from that web server, he will compromise another web server in the corporate network, and from that server, he will compromise a web server in the control system DMZ, and from the control system DMZ, he may compromise an application server in the control system, and when he is in the control system, he may have access to the remote terminal unit in the power grid. Now we are going to describe this movement with the vulnerability multigraph. Before describing the graph, we are going to provide a definition. Let us say that we have two nodes, V1 and V2. An edge vulnerability E from V1 to V2 corresponds to a vulnerability hosted by an application on V2 that the system rules and protocols allow to access from V1. So from V1, it is possible to compromise V2 and get access to V2 by exploiting a particular vulnerable application. So for the definition, we call phi the set of all vulnerabilities, and phi of E is the vulnerability associated to the edge E. Node V2 is the head of edge E, and node V1 is the tail of edge E. So we can describe this movement with the direct acyclic graph consisting of four layers. Here we have omitted the vulnerabilities that can go through the firewall. So in this graph, we are not going to see the firewall. We analyze only vulnerability that can go through the firewall. So you have the corporate DMZ, the corporate network, the control system DMZ, and then the control system. And then to reach the control system, a remote attacker must move laterally in this graph from node to node until reaching a vulnerable target in the control system. Here is a particular example with six vulnerabilities. Here are the vulnerabilities phi1, phi2, up to phi6. And the vulnerabilities are coded with color. So the color purple is for vulnerability phi1, the color black is for vulnerability phi4, the color green is for vulnerability phi3. The initial position of the attacker is at node V0, and the attacker can exploit nine edges, and the color of each edge corresponds to the vulnerability of that edge. For example, edge E1 has the purple color, so edge E1 corresponds to vulnerability phi1. Edge E7 has a black color, so it corresponds to vulnerability phi4. Here is the matrix of action at node V0. The row action corresponds to the attacker. So the attacker has nine possible edges to exploit, and the column action corresponds to the defender action. The defender is going to choose one vulnerable application to shut down, and when that vulnerable application will be shut down, it will disconnect all the edges corresponding to that vulnerabilities. If the attacker exploits edge E7, And then, if the attacker exploits edge E7, then the defender must disconnect the vulnerable application 5-4, because edge E7 corresponds to vulnerability 5-4. But if the defender doesn't shut down the vulnerability 5-4, then the attacker will be able to move forward. So in this example, the defender shut down the vulnerability 5-1, and then the attacker exploits H7. Because 5-1 is different than 5-4, the attacker is going to move to the next node, V3. So V3 is the head of E7. So the attacker is going to move to the next node, V3, and all vulnerability, all edges associated to vulnerability V1 will be connected. So at the next step, the attacker is now at V3. And in the network, we don't have any more the vulnerability V1.
Gael?
Yes.
This is Alan from the University of Illinois. Does the defender know which vulnerabilities are active and where? Because it seems like this model depends a lot on the defender being very aware of the vulnerabilities in their own environment.
Could you repeat the question, please?
Does the defender know which vulnerabilities are active where?
At each position, the defenders knows the vulnerabilities that are active, and we assume that there is an intrusion detection system such that the defender has detected the presence of the attacker. So now the defender want to choose quickly the right application to shut down to avoid the attacker using that application. So the attacker knows the active vulnerabilities.
Okay.
I don't know if I answer your questions.
Yeah, okay, but I guess that depends on, for some example, something like a zero day that the defender doesn't know about, then how do you handle that?
In this example, there are no, in this example, we assume that the defenders and the attackers have the same knowledge of vulnerability, so there is no zero-day attack. But I am going to have a comment on zero-day attack, because a zero-day attack in this graph corresponds to an edge that the attacker can see, but the defender cannot see that edge. So a zero-day exploit will be, for example, an hidden edge that only the attacker can see.
That's okay, let's continue.
Okay, so in the same way, at the position V3, the attacker is going to choose one edge among the five possible edges, and the defender is going to shut down one vulnerable application among the five remaining. So in this example, the attacker exploits edge E3, and then the defender shut down the vulnerable application V2. And because V2 is different from the vulnerability of HE3 corresponds to 5-5. Because of that, the attacker will move to the next node, V10. So the attacker is at node V10. And at node V10, the attacker exploits HE6. And the defender shut down 5-3, and because 5-3 is different than the vulnerability of H6, filtering. Filtering is the vulnerability of edge issues is filtering, sorry. So the defender is going to shut down the vulnerability corresponding to the edge that the attacker wants to exploit. So because the defender has guessed the right vulnerability, the attacker will be blocked on node V10. And then all vulnerability, all edges associated to vulnerability, filtering will be disconnected. So at the next step, the attacker is still at node V10. And then the attacker will choose another edge to exploit. So the attacker will choose, for example, edge E2. And the defender is going to shut down 5-4. Edge E2 correspond to 5-5. And because 5-5 is different than 5-4, the attacker is going to move forward to the next node, V14. There. And at this 14, there is only one edge remaining. And because there is only one edge remaining, the attacker is going to shut down the vulnerability 5-5 corresponding to that edge, and the attacker will want to exploit that edge, but the vulnerable application will be disconnected, and then the attacker will be blocked at edge V14, and it is finished for the attacker. So we can describe this process as a game with two players, the attacker and the defender, and the game is played at each node when the attacker moves deeper in the network. So here we are going to describe a Markov game that we will use to solve this problem. Markov game can be described as six tuple, S, A, O, P, R, and gamma, where S, capital S, is the set of state of the games. In our example, the set of games will be the node of the graph. So at each node, a game will be played between the attacker and the defender. We have capital A, which is the set of action of the maximizer. The maximizer is the role player. In our case, it is the attacker. So the set of action of the attacker will be, for example, the edge to exploit. And we have capital O, which is the set of action of the minimizer. The minimizer here will be the defender. And the set of action of the defender will be the vulnerability to shut down. We talk of maximizer and minimizer because we have a reward function. In the game, the goal of the attacker will be to maximize the rewards. The reward can be, for example, how much the value or the impact created, and then the attacker will want to create the maximum damages as possible, while the defender will want to minimize the damages. We have a transition Markovian model that tells us the probability to go from one state to another. So it tells us how to move from one node to another. And then we have a discounted factor. The discounted factor tells us how the attacker choose his reward. Some attacker may be interested by short-term reward, while other attacker may be interested by long-term reward. So long-term reward means, for example, that the attacker wants to reach the control system and that the attacker doesn't look at the value of immediate nodes. So the map of the game has this shape. So we have the role player, we have the column player, and for each combination, action of the role player and the column player, we have a particular reward. So for example, if the attacker, if the role player take action A1 and if the column player take action O1, we will have this reward at state S and so on. Now, the goal of the game is to find the appropriate policy. The policy gives for each player the appropriate action to take. So the policy of the defender will tell the defender which vulnerability to shut down, and the policy of the attacker will tell the attacker which edge to exploit at each position. So before in typical game, we have a Bellman function that are used to solve the optimum policy. So the Bellman function are the Q function and the W function. And the Q function capture the global reward of each player. So the Q function capture the immediate reward. So the immediate reward is the reward that each player has when the role player take the action A, the column player take the action O at state S. And then the future reward are the reward that the player will have in the next state when they will move from state S to the next state. So for example, the defender can choose to give a max a high reward to the attacker immediately, such that the future reward of the attacker will be low. And this means that, for example, the defender can allow the attacker to move successfully from one node to another node, such that in the next node, the attacker doesn't have the possibility to move forward. So in a scenario like that, you will have a high immediate reward, but a low future reward. And this is the algorithm to solve this problem. So solving that problem consists in determining the policy pi, p, and the value of each node, w. If I come back again in the slide, so the policy p is a probability distribution at each state over the set of action and give us the and tell us which action to take at every state. So as I said earlier, if you want to apply this problem to lateral movement, the attacker will be the maximizer and the defender will be the minimizer. And each node VS will indicate the position of the attacker, and then the action of the attacker will be the set of edge, and the action of the defender will be the set of vulnerabilities, and this will be the matrix of the game. The matrix of the game is almost like the matrix action that we saw previously. The action of the attacker is in the row, and the action of the defender is in column. And the attacker chooses at each state, that is to say at each node, the attacker chooses one edge or spot, and the defender chooses one vulnerability to shut down. And then the game will be repeated to another node, or the game will be repeated to the same node. Now we are going to analyze how we define the reward. Exploiting a vulnerability has a cost, and when the attacker exploits a vulnerability, if the defender shut down the same vulnerability that the attacker is exploiting, then the effort of the attacker are in vain, because the defender was able to guess the movement of the attacker. And then the immediate reward of the attacker will be negative, because the attacker will have spent a lot of energy to export something and we have no gain. Now, if the vulnerability of the edge is different than the vulnerability that the defender is shutting down, then the attacker will move successfully to the next node, and the immediate reward will consist of two components. The first component will be the cost of export of that vulnerability, and the second component will be the attractivity of the next node. So the higher is the attractivity of the next node, the higher is the immediate reward. And the attractivity of the next node depends on the function of the next node. So the next node can be a business workstation, it can be a server. A server will have a higher attractivity than a standard business workstation. Here we are going to present some simulation results. First, we present how the cost is calculated. We calculate the cost of export of each vulnerability with the common vulnerability scoring system. That is a standard to access vulnerability. So it consists of three components: access vector, access complexity, and access authentication. And basically, the CVSS score of a vulnerability tells us how easy it is to export a particular vulnerability. And by construction, it is coded between 1.4 and 10. And because we want a negative cost, we are going to compute a composite function, such that when that function is high, it means that it is easy, and when that function is low, it means that it is difficult. So this is just a translation such that the cost is negative and such that the easiest one corresponds to the high one and the lowest one corresponds to the most difficult. And in our simulation, this is the type of node that we consider in the different layers, from the corporate DMZ, corporate network, control system DMZ, and control system. So in the corporate DMZ, we took three types of nodes: FTP server, web server, and authentication server. And when we go high in the graph, the attractivity of node becomes high. So we took this value for the attractivity, just for example. So in the control system, the attractivity is 100, because when you are in the control system, you can easily get access to the power grid. When you are in the control system DMZ, the attractivity is divided by 2, because when you are in the control system DMZ, you can reach the control system, and when you are in the control system, you can reach the power grid. In the corporate network, the attractivity is 25, that is divided by 4. So when you are in the corporate network, you can get access to the control system DMZ, and from the control system DMZ, you can get access to the control system. And the attractivity of corporate DMZ is 12.5. So we took all nodes with the same operating system, and we choose some products of the market, and we consider the vulnerability from the previous month, so from August 2017. And we took the vulnerability depends on the type of product and depends also from manufacturers. So some manufacturers may have some vulnerability that other one may not have. Some type of product may have some vulnerability that other type of product may not have. And for each position, the attacker chooses one edge vulnerability to exploit. And the defender at each time step chooses a vulnerability application to shut down. And when the defender disconnects a vulnerable application, this automatically cuts all the edges corresponding to that application. And because we want to have a random graph, we put link between layer, we generate link between layer with a Bernoulli try compatibility layer with a parameter of p. This is just graph, a random graph. So we took a graph with 100 nodes and with this distribution, 6 in the corporate DMZ, 64 in the corporate, 4 in the control DMZ, and 26 in the control system. So basically, 70% of the nodes are in the corporate and corporate DMZ, and 30% are in the control system and control system DMZ. This is the number of time it takes for the algorithm to converge. And one important metric for resilience is the rapidity. Because when we detect the presence of the attacker, the network administrator should know exactly, should know quickly what action to take. And recent cyber attacks tell us that sometimes it is difficult to stop the malware. For some attacks, it may have taken some hours to stop the malware. For some others, it may have taken something like 1 week. So rapidity is important to improve the resilience of the power grid. And here we can see that in less than 1,000 iterations, this is something like less than 1 minute with our computer, we are able to reach the convergence, and the algorithm converge, and we know exactly what action to take. And the conversion speed is affected by the discounted factor. So when the discounted factor increases, the conversion speed increases, but it remains low compared to what a human can think and take. Now we are going to analyze the strategy. If the strategy of the attacker is deterministic, then the optimal strategy of the defender is also deterministic. For example, let us say that the attacker wants to exploit the shortest path. Then for the defender, the optimal defense strategy will be to shut down the vulnerability corresponding to the shortest path. Now, if at this position the attacker wants to exploit, for example, the least code edges, so for the defender, the optimal strategy will be to disconnect the vulnerabilities corresponding to least code edges. And if at each node the attacker wants to move toward the next most attractive node, for the defender, the optimal strategy will be to disconnect the vulnerability corresponding to the most attractive node. Now, if the strategy of the attacker is random, so if we don't know how the attacker is going to behave, we need to know what will be the optimal strategy. So now, if the strategy of the attacker is random, the Markov game will tell us the optimal strategy. And when we solve the Markov game, and when we compute 1,000 Monte Carlo attacks, so we have computed 1,000 Monte Carlo attacks from a remote position to the control system, and some of the attack may reach the control system, some other may fail because the defender may be able to stop the attacker. So we compute the result of all those Monte Carlo attacks, and we plot a graph like this. So in the x-axis, we have the corporate DMZ, the control system DMZ, and the control system. And in the y-axis, we have the number of attacks. We have the number of attacks that have reached this layer. For example, if the attacker, for example, when the attacker uses a randomly and uniformly strategy. That is to say, at each node, the attacker just shows randomly and uniformly the edge to exploit. In that case, we have 60 attacks that were blocked in the corporate DMZ, and then something like 35 attacks that reach the corporate network, and something like one or two attacks that reach the control system DMZ, and something like five attacks that reach the control system. So at the equilibrium, corresponds to the case when the attacker and the defender use the optimal solution of the Markov game. So if the attacker uses the Markov game and if the defender uses the Markov game, then no player could increase his payoff by definition. So when the Markov, when the defender plays the Markov game, the attacker cannot increase his reward. And when the attacker uses the Markov game, the defender cannot increase his reward. So this is the result when both player chooses the Markov game. At the Markov game, we have something like 20% of the attack that reach the control system. And this is the optimal for the attacker. The attacker cannot have a yield of more than 13% if the attacker chooses another strategy. So the Markov game tells us that we can minimize the number of attacks that reach the control system to 20%. And it is not possible when the defender uses the Markov game, it is not possible for the attacker to have more than 20% of chances to reach the control system. So this will be the optimal strategy for the defender, and the attack with this policy, the attacker cannot have more than 20% of attack that reach the control system. And then for the corporate DMZ, we have something like 5% of attack, and for the corporate we have also something like 13%, and for the corporate DMZ we have something like 55% of attack. And globally, the average attractivity of the last node reach is 35, and that is correspond to a location like the corporate DMZ. So the average location of the attacker at the end of the attack is corporate DMZ. And the attacker cannot have a better result than this one when the defender uses a Markov game. Any other strategy of the attacker will decrease the performances of the attack. So for example, if the attacker doesn't want to use a Markov game, and if the attacker wants to use a randomly uniform distribution, then instead of having 20% of chances to reach the control system, we have something like 5% decrease. And still looking at random strategy and as robustness, we may want also to decrease the speed of attack, because you know you have a graph with four layers: the control, the corporate DMZ, the corporate network, the control system DMZ, and then the control system. And normally, if the attack is linear, it will take something like four time steps to reach the control system. But because the defender wants to slow down the attack, the defender is going to shut down some application to block the attacker. So this is the statistical distribution of the time needed for the attacker to reach the control system with 100 attacks. When bot use a Markov strategy, we have something like 11 attacks that reach the control system with the time of four times. So 11 attacks was pretty much linear But if the attacker chooses another strategy, then the number of linear attacks will be decreased to 4. So when we use a Markov strategy, this tells us slow down the speed of attack such a way that the attacker cannot have a better speed by using another policy. So the average attack duration is 4.5 when using a Markov, and if you use another, if the attacker wants to change his strategy, then he will not benefit from that change. For example, if the attacker uses a randomly uniformly policy, then the attack duration will be 4.7. So in this way, this increase the robustness of the system, because in some attack, the attacker will not be able to reach the control system, and so critical assets will be protected, and it will also give more time to the defender to optimize the strategy to protect the network, because when the duration of the attack increases, the defender has more time to find better solution. So this is the conclusion of the work. The Markov can improve, Markov game can improve system resilience by increasing the rapidity of the response. So the response delay is some 3 seconds, and there is no need, we don't need a human in the loop. So the response is automatic, and quickly we know exactly what vulnerability to shut down. We can increase the robustness of the attack by redirecting the malware into part of the graph where some critical asset cannot be reached. So we are going to protect some sensitive target, and we increase the resourcefulness by providing the optimal action at each point of the system. So this work was built with known vulnerability that the attacker can exploit to move laterally from node to node. We have to continue this work with some zero-day exploits. So zero-day exploits, we will have asymmetric information between the attacker and the defender. So the graph of the attacker will be different than the graph of the defender. And then the attacker will be able to see some hidden edge that the defender will not be able to see. And then we will also have to consider the physical layer with the substation, and then calculate the power lost due to cyber attack. So this is the end of my presentation, and thank you for your attention.
Okay, first off, I want to thank the speaker. Are there any questions or comments out on the teleconference?
One.
Twice. I have something, Gael. It seems that the defender strategy is to remove access to a vulnerable application.
Yes.
Okay. So if that's the case, then I don't think it's a zero-sum game, because there is some cost to the defender to remove access to a particular application.
Yes. There is a cost for both of them, for the attacker and for the attacker and the defender. And in this game, our way of thinking is that the interest of the attacker is opposite to the interest of the defender. So in the reward of the attacker. Let me find this line. Yes. In the reward of the attacker, there is a cost of exploiting a vulnerability, and again, when the movement is successful, and
so what I'm saying is that the zero sum condition to hull, that would be the defenders would be the negative of that.
Yes, and the defender would be.
I question that that would be true.
Yes, of course. It is possible to define another reward function instead of taking the opposite. So the first step of this was of this work was to consider a zero-sum game. That is to say, the interest of the defender is exactly the interest of the defender is the reward of the defender is exactly the opposite of the attacker one. It is true that you can consider more sophisticated games with a non-zero-sum game, and then in the reward of the defender, you will compute a cost of action, and then you will also define a particular reward for the defender for each action, and then in such a way the game will not be a zero-sum game in this one, like this one.
Okay, any other questions?
Yes.
All right. Okay, thank you all. And we'll see each other next week.
See you next Friday. Have a good weekend, guys.